I hope that you're a little bit disappointed because I've now defined all this. I have that big toolbox, but I didn't use anything of it. So let me remedy that and now show you how Fourier transform can be used to invert the radon transform, and that there's in fact a very, very close relation between the Fourier transform and the radon transform. And what I want to show you is the Fourier slice theorem or projection theorem, which is in fact the main basic result of radon transform analysis. And it says, let F any function in the Schwarz space of Rn, let theta unit vector in Sn minus 1 and theta in R. Then we have that the radon transform, or the Fourier transform of the radon transform of F evaluated of S at theta and sigma. And since this has two parameters, I need to say what parameter, with respect to which parameter I take the Fourier transform, and it's with respect to the second argument over here. The Fourier transform of the radon transform evaluated at theta and sigma is up to a factor of 2 pi n minus 1 over 2, the same as the two-dimensional Fourier transform of F evaluated at sigma times theta. So there's a one-dimensional Fourier transform over here with respect to the second argument, n minus one n-dimensional Fourier transform over here. And if you can't memorize what the factor over here is, there's a 1 over square root 2 pi here when you take the radon transform. There's a 1 over square root of 2 pi to the n when you take the Fourier transform here. And the difference is just this 2 pi to the n minus 1 over 2, and that's exactly where it comes from. Okay, as I said, that's the main result, and in particular, it says that the radon transform is invertible. So our task of recovering the function from its radon transform is feasible. What would the algorithm be? And we look at that in a little bit more detail at the beginning of the next lecture. Now, if I have all the data measured, so if I have Rf of theta and S for all theta and all S, then for a fixed theta, I can take the Fourier transform of that. So I can compute Rf hat of theta and sigma. So that gives me the Fourier transform, the two-dimensional Fourier transform of F on the line sigma times theta. I can assemble all these, and for all sigma and all theta, so I get F hat, the Fourier transform of F everywhere on R2, and I can do the inverse Fourier transform, and then I recover F. So that's an algorithm for getting from the data to the function F. We'll see that this is very hard to implement numerically, so this is not done. We'll see that there are better ways of doing the numerics, but at least analytically at this point, it's already clear that the radon transform is invertible, and we even have an algorithm, although it might not be a good one. Okay, for the proof, that's now extremely simple. Let's take the Fourier transform of Rf with respect to the second argument. The second argument is one-dimensional, so we have a factor of 1 over square root of 2 pi. And so that's integral over R, Rf of theta and s, e to the minus is sigma ds. And now I plug in the definition of Rf. So that was integral over x times theta is s, f of x dx, only thing that changed here. And now I observe that this is a plane integral, or in two dimensions, it's just a line integral. And we are stacking all these line integrals. So so we are really getting the whole space over here. So by Fubini, I find that this is nothing but the integral over Rn, f of x. And I had e to the minus is sigma, but s was x times theta. So I plug this in over here. And so this is exactly the same as the integral f of x e to the minus ix sigma times theta dx. And I took the sigma from this place to this place. Now, if you look at this, this is exactly the definition of the Fourier transform of f up to that factor 1 over square root of 2 pi over here. So what's missing is 2 pi to the n minus 1 over 2. And then we have the Fourier transform of sigma times theta. That's great. We'll interpret this, as I said. But for the time being, I announced that we'll not be looking at the Röntgen transform. But since this is the basic result, one would ask that, at least for n larger than 2, does the Röntgen transform, X-ray transform, also satisfy Fourier inversion formula of that kind? And the answer is yes, it does. It's a little bit different, of course. And the Röntgen transform was defined for theta in Sn minus 1 and xi in theta perp. And we take the Fourier transform of that function with respect to theta perp. We'll see how that is done. So that's an n minus 1 dimensional Fourier transform on theta perp. And I say that this is the same as square root of 2 pi times the Fourier transform of xi for theta in Sn minus 1. Now, the first thing that you will notice is the theta is gone, right? It's not on the right-hand side, and that is true. So that formula can be used for any theta, of course, as long as theta is perpendicular to xi. You already see that this seems to be overdetermined, right? I mean, I have many ways of computing f hat of xi. I just need any theta in Sn minus 1, and then the relation over here is correct. And for n larger than 2, of course. For n equal to 2, I have only two choices, and that's the overdeterminedness I already looked at. Now, let's look at 3D. Why could that be that not measuring not everything of PF, not measuring PF for every theta and every psi makes sense? Well, think of R3 as a stack of planes, as a stack of two-dimensional planes. Then I can reconstruct just by taking measurements of the Radon transform, of the Röntgen transform, just in every plane. Right. I mean, just assume that I'm just taking the measurements in every plane. Since that's now a two-dimensional problem, I can reconstruct, maybe using the Radon transform as above. So I can actually invert in all of these planes, and I can recover my function f. But I only measured a very, very small portion of the data. I only measured the theta for the thetas that are in one plane. So it's sufficient to measure only a small portion of the data to be able to reconstruct uniquely. And so that already gives us an idea why these inversion formulas for the Röntgen transform, for the X-ray transform, are probably not very useful, because if they require all the data, then that's far too much and that will never be measured. Okay, but nevertheless, let's prove that. So we have the Fourier transform of Röntgen transform of f, so that's pf hat of theta and xi, and of course we require that theta times xi is zero. Now that's a Fourier transform in the n minus one dimensional hyperplane that's perpendicular to theta. So we have a factor of 1 over 2 pi n minus 1 over 2. Integral over x times theta is s, e to the minus ix xi, pf of theta and x dx. I plug in the definition of pf, and so that now becomes the integral over r, f of x plus t times theta dt dx. And observing that xi times theta is zero, I can, instead of x, I can also write x plus t times theta over here, because theta times psi is 0. So that doesn't change anything. But now I can set, of course, set this equal to z. And I can set this equal to z. And you see this is just the definition of the Fourier transform, because this now again covers all of Rn. So we have the Fourier transform again, with the exception of a factor of square root of 2 pi. And plugging that in, I get the formula that I wanted to prove. Okay, so that gives us a first idea of what reconstruction algorithms would look like. It also makes clear that the Radon transform is in fact invertible. So this may come as a surprise, because for inverse problems, we always said that might not be the case. Well, for the Radon transform, that is the case. And yeah, we'll look into this formula in a little bit more detail on Monday. And I wish you a great weekend. So hopefully see you then.